as we celebrate this Holy Week leading up to Easter Sunday, as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I always go back to Isaiah 53. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of the dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich in death, in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. And it's because of Isaiah 53 that we get to go on to Isaiah 54. Amen. Sing, O barren, thou that didst not bear, break forth into singing and cry aloud, thou that didst not travail with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the unmarried wife, saith the Lord. Enlarge the place of thy tent, and let them stretch forth the curtains of thine habitations. Spare not, lengthen thy cords, and strengthen thy stakes. For thou shalt break forth on the right hand and on the left, and thy seed shall inherit the Gentiles, and make the desolate cities to be inhabited. Fear not, for thou shalt not be ashamed, neither be thou confounded, for thou shalt not be put to shame. For thou shalt forget the shame of thy youth, and shalt not remember the reproach of thy widowhood any more. For thy Maker is thine husband, and the Lord of hosts is his name. And thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, the God of the whole earth, shall he be called. For the Lord hath called thee as a woman forsaken and grieved in spirit, and a wife of youth, when thou wast refused, saith thy God. For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies will I gather thee. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be wroth with thee, nor rebuke thee. For the mountains shall depart, and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on thee. O thou afflicted, tossed with tempest and not comforted, behold, I will lay thy stones with fair colors, and lay thy foundations with sapphires. And I will make thy windows of agates, and thy gates of carbuncles, and all thy borders of pleasant stones. And all thy children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children. In righteousness shalt thou be established. Thou shalt be far from oppression, for thou shalt not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come near thee. Behold, they shall surely gather together, but not by me. Whosoever shall gather together against thee shall fall for thy sake. Behold, I have created the smith that bloweth the coals in the fire, and that bringeth forth an instrument for his work. and I have created the waster to destroy. No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. It is finished.
Yes.
It is finished. And I hope that as we talk to people, this is always, you know, a time when people have it on their mind. You know, Easter, the secular Easter, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I just encourage you to share that it's finished and that it is the good news. Yes. That his mercy lasts forever, that he is a good, good father.
Yes.
If we will just come to him and trust him, he will make all the difference. In
Amen.
Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Anyone have any prayer requests or testimonies tonight? Yeah, Sally.
Tammy called. Dan had surgery yesterday on his foot, and he's in a lot of pain. He can't stand. They gave him a boot to wear, and he's really off balance with this silly boot. So she wants prayer for him. And also, we got a text from Jody. Her aunt, Debbie, they're going tonight to pray for her. She needs healing.
Okay.
That wasn't Debbie Hart, was it?
No.
Okay.
No.
Her mom's sister.
And we were talking, apparently, prayer for Darlene.
She's doing fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a praise the Lord.
You can say a praise the Lord.
Yeah. She had an episode and it's fine. Yeah.
Rick Andreas, they're moving him back to the VA hospital. They basically had to drain out the area where they took the gallbladder out. I didn't know until, I don't know if I mentioned it Sunday or not, but there was actually gangrene in the gallbladder.
Oh.
That's how bad it was. It was pretty much could have been a fatal situation. But anyway, Nancy wrote that he had two drain tubes in him and stuff. And one may have been having to stay in there the rest of his life, but they took one out today and possibly take the other one out tomorrow and home Friday. So
praise the Lord.
And for his situation.
Thank you, Lord. Yeah.
And Cindy went to Iowa City today for a follow-up from the time she was over there in the hospital and stuff. And got a good report. She's doing
yeah.
real good, so doesn't have to go back for a while on that situation. She'll just pray for the rest of the situations and the mountains that have been created and those things that we're casting into the midst of the sea. So.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, agreeing with you. Anyone? Yeah, Tim.
Yes. Sheila had a request on Facebook for
Evelyn. Yeah. So happy because the day he came back and passed, and I talked to him, and it's a big smile, and he said, "Now I go feed my family because he got his license," and I just told him to look up.
Amen.
To point, now pointing like this, look up.
Amen.
And said, thank God, and to me, just to see that look in his eyes, to know that God had blessed him and he's able to provide. I just thank God for the opportunity to be able to share God with them and be able to pray with them.
Yeah.
You know, because if they ask me to pray with them or pray for them, you know, and I'm not going to lie to people and just say, yeah, sure, I'll pray. No, I will guarantee you I'm going to pray
Amen.
And lift you up before
yes.
the Lord. Because we had an incident where, like last night,
Karen Goodson. She lost her sister suddenly this week. She just collapsed and was gone. She was young, I think, too. And I don't know if they even know what happened. And she's asking for prayer. She's asking for encouragement. She's asking for the Lord to get her through this time of grief. So pray for her and her family as they mourn the loss of her dear sister. Yeah, Mike.
For the women's conference, Tim was passing, moving tissues around out here, putting tissues out and stuff like that. And I thought, you know, that's cool, you know, it's that time of year. People sniffles and stuff. But the Lord said, no, that's not what they're for. It's for the women's conference. I said, what do you mean for a women's conference? He says, there are going to be a lot of women set free, and they're going to be weeping and sobbing because they're getting free and stuff like that. That's what these tissues are here for. So,
praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Yeah, Alvin.
Carol told me she's her innards are not feeling so well, and she thinks it's because of some medication she's taken, and so she's cutting that out. But otherwise, she's doing pretty good. But you know, just that ache, you know, is just not comfortable.
Yeah.
Just one of the prayer requests that we'll have to pray for too is just the young people that, you know, they have a lot going on. I mean, you know, we grew up and we had our issues, but they do have a lot of issues to deal with. And,
yeah.
And we just ask that,
yes.
You know, God turn their hearts around and, you know, let them live for God. I mean, we grew up in the church, which was such a blessing, but everybody doesn't grow up in the church.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody doesn't have that foundation. And I think that's when we see somebody and God puts us on our heart to pray for them, or you see somebody acting up, you know, rather than just criticize them, oh, I wish they'd just quit doing that, you know, take them on as a prayer. So I'm going to pray for them, because that'll make a big difference. They may never know your name or anything like that, but to pray and to see those lives change.
Yeah,
I think it's just a group we just really need to lift up.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
And speaking of youth, for the youth group, I know Kennedy and Nicole were hungry. They gave their hearts to the Lord at the winter jam, and I don't want them to lose out on that fervor, or to get discouraged because other kids aren't coming. That's all very often. I just don't want them to get discouraged. Shaylee went through the same thing when her friends moved and she wasn't able to come. If I could just get Shaylee here with Kennedy and stuff, I know something was starting, but I just can't seem to get Shaylee moved. She's 14 now, so she's all grown up for a few years, and then she'll get tracked in the track. But I want to catch her in these years. These are the critical years right now. So I pray for the youth. Pray for the youth.
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe it will increase money. But I also think that, I know from my own personal experience, we didn't go to church on a regular basis. We went, I mean, my parents would send us, but every time you can get them in the church, they're going to experience the presence of the Lord, whether they know that or not.
Right.
I mean, they may not have a theological understanding of it,
mm-hmm.
but it makes God real.
Yes.
You know, I mean, it brings him to the forefront, at least for that time.
Mm-hmm.
When they get older, even if they, and we want them to live for God, because we know that's the best life for them, that they can live a good, blessed life. But even if they don't, when they come to the end of themselves, they get to a situation where their life is in turmoil,
they know.
It comes back to them.
Yep.
If they know there is a God. Now, they may not know much beyond that, but that's enough to get them to the Lord, you know. So I think every time they come, no matter how young they are, or how old for that matter, it exposes them to the presence of the Lord, and it makes him real to them. So when they do come to a place of decision, a crisis or whatever it might be,
right.
God's in the picture too. There's an option there for them that they wouldn't have had otherwise. So I just encourage anybody working with kids or with youth, like in any ministry, you don't always get to see the results.
Right.
But that's no reason to not continue to
sow,
because somebody's
right.
going to see that the harvest come.
Right.
Whether it's us or not, it's another issue. But
right.
our job is to sow the seed and trust the Lord.
So last time Nicole and Kennedy were here, Kennedy just to let her know. And then when Kennedy was here by herself Sunday, she went down to help me with a project real quick. On the way out, I stopped and talked to her. I said, you know, I only get to talk to you guys, you girls, for 45 minutes to an hour a week. I says, my job is to help you understand who the Lord is. He has tools, he has things to put in your hands and in your spirit, that when you run into life's crisis, you will run into the crisis and you will know, you know, basically how to handle it.
Mm-hmm.
I said, this is, and I only got heavy for a few years for an hour a week or 45 minutes to an hour a week, and enough time that I have to instill into you the things of the Lord. So you are ready when those things come up, because, you know, Harry Potter and all these other things that these kids mm-hmm. and stuff are reading, they're not going to, it's not going to do squat when the rubber hits the road.
Yeah, and I would just ask that you pray for us as Sunday school teachers, as those who are ministering to youth, because they have some questions.
Yes.
Let me tell you.
Yeah.
Last Sunday, I was telling Michael that we had an interesting discussion about polygamy, about how do you have more than one wife? And I'm like, well, how much is too much? I mean, you just never know what's going to come up.
You know, in the opposite.
And I just always change path,
yeah.
Diversion, distraction. But these kids are hungry for all sorts of information.
Yeah. And the obverse of that, I had a conversation with somebody that was talking about questions that nobody's asking, but
right.
that particular person.
Yeah.
And so sometimes, in our pursuit to answer questions,
right.
we get ahead of the game.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
If they're asking, that makes sense. You want to be
right.
able to respond to it. Sometimes we're trying to give answers for questions they don't have yet.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's
right.
like, just like telling a 3-year-old
right.
where babies come from biologically,
right.
you know.
Right.
Just, they would just want to know that it's in mommy's belly and that's good enough, you know what
yep.
I'm saying? So
yep.
it's just a fine line sometimes.
Yeah.
You want to give them what God's put in their heart and
right.
cause them to cry out
right.
without going past, you know, where they are.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, these kids are smart.
Yeah, it's a whole different world.
Well, and you know, I was going to say Bible stories that never used to cause question about certain things. I would never have thought to ask about first, second, or third wife, or whatever. I don't know. Just you never know. You never know what's going to come up downstairs, and the Lord, the little hearts are hungry, and you know, they want the Lord to shine. You know that they know who He is. And that they know there's people they can come talk to and ask questions, right?
Yeah,
that's the other thing, is that they are free to be curious, and they're free to search, and they're free to ask.
Yeah.
You know, that's important, that they have someone that they can go to and trust to ask those questions.
Right.
And I'll just ask forgiveness if I get if you get a call from a parent that says, walk in the line,
yeah.
change the topic. And James is no longer allowed to bring up Bathsheba in class anymore. Anyway, anyone else tonight? Any prayer requests? Yeah, Alvin.
Talking about the youth and coming to the Lord, I'm a little Amish fellow, and going to Florida with my grandparents, and we sit at church service, you know, and I knew how to sing the songs, but you know, nothing else really made sense. And there was the preacher was sneaky. He said, how many Christians out there do we have, you know? And you know, well, there's a whole bunch of them that raised their hands. Now, you that didn't raise your hands, wouldn't you like to? And 9-year-old, you know, I didn't know what I was doing, but, you know, I think I was there shaking or something, because another fellow come up and he said, do you want me to go with you? And he did. And wow. And that, of course, the downside of it, you know, I went and told Grandma, you know, the Amish style is when you're 17 or 18, then you go to church. I mean, take church seriously. And so I told her what happened, you know. Oh no, we don't do that till we're 17, 18. And talk about breaking my heart. Oh, but
wonderful. All right, well, let's stand and go to the Lord tonight. Heavenly Father, we just come before you tonight, Lord. We pray for those who have needs tonight, for Jody and her family, Lord, where they go to pray and minister, Lord, and speak your word, speak healing into that situation. Pray for all those that need healing in their bodies, Lord. Thank you for a good report, for the healing that has occurred. Lord, and we ask for comfort for Karen and her family, Lord, and the loss of her sister. Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for the miraculous healing that you've done, Lord. We thank you for Cindy's healing. We thank you for Darlene's healing, Lord. We thank you for all of the work that you're doing in this house, Lord, and in this body, Lord. We lift up the women's conference to you tonight, Lord, that you just encourage all those to come and participate, to come and receive, Lord, to bring a friend, bring five friends. Just come and minister to one another, Lord. We pray for our youth, Lord, as their little hearts are hungry, as their personalities are forming, Lord, that you would make yourself real to them, Lord, that you would lay the foundation that will be the rest of their life, Lord, knowing you and trusting you, Lord, that you plant those seeds, Lord, that you be with the teachers, Lord, be with the adults as we just have interaction with them here at the church, that they know that this is a safe place and that you are a good God. We ask you to bless everyone here tonight, Lord. We ask you to be with us tonight in this service as we lift you up and worship you. Transform our minds by the hearing of your word tonight. Let our minds be renewed. And let your name be lifted high, Jesus. We pray for Eastern Gatehouse of Prayer. It's coming Friday, Lord. And we pray for Resurrection Sunday, Lord, a time when we celebrate the finished work of the cross, Lord, the resurrection of you, Lord, that you defeated death, hell, and the grave. What do we have to fear, Lord? We thank you that you humbled yourself to the death of the cross, Lord. We thank you that you shed your blood, that by your stripes we are healed, and that you have exchanged your righteousness for our sin, Lord. Thank you. We thank you, Lord. Thank you that you called us each by name, Lord, and called us your own. Be with us tonight, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Dondoramo onkarama shondo kokoria yama patako iriyama asando kokoria. Dondoramo onkarama asando okarama ankarama anko totoriaya. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus. Just a reminder, if you brought a cell phone, to go ahead and silence it or turn it off tonight. And yes, this Friday, April 14th, Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Amen. And the last part of it, we will have communion. We're going to bring up tables and basically have a Last Supper up here. I'll try to get a hold of Eric and or Sarah to see if they can bring a bottle of kombucha and some bread. Otherwise, if they can't, then we'll go to Plan B. But we're just basically have a feast. Just a feast of fellowship, basically.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing it in remembrance of him. I already see a picture of it. It's going to be cool. I see the center seat where Christ would sit. That seat naturally will not be sat in by any of us. We'll just let the presence of the Lord take it, and we'll go from there.
Praise God.
Good
Pete
prayer.
Washing too? Pete washing too?
Nothing I'm aware of.
Let me get a pedicure first. Let me get a pedicure first. I wouldn't go there. And Saturday, April 22nd, we've been talking a lot about the Women of Influence Conference. I have more postcards. I'll bring them on Sunday. I gave them to Michael in case my meeting ran long today, and it did not. And then Michael was so careful with them, he put them in his car that we did not bring tonight. So there will be more postcards and invitations on Sunday.
Amen.
All right, let's speak the word tonight. Will
you
not revive
us
again? that your people may rejoice in you, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Thank you, Lord.
Don, or Ron, I did that twice. Ron, you... I've already driven like... I've been in the car for 4 hours today. It's been a long day. I apologize.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Let's thank Him for being so good. Thank you, Jesus. God, you are good. Hallelujah. And your goodness and your mercy endureth forever. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for being a good, good God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless you tonight, Lord. Thank you for those that have gathered here tonight, Lord. We know that you're with us because you're in us, Lord. We pray your blessing upon each one of us in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Give the Lord a hand, please. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. Appreciate your sharing with us. Mike, Suzanne, and James, thank you for leading us in worship. Praise God. God is good. Amen.
Amen.
I probably said this before, but I just happened to notice it. There's a, you know, as you get a little older, your memory isn't always quite as what you'd like it to be. Praise the Lord. I'm not confessing that. I'm just saying that I've heard that from other people. Praise the Lord. But there was this old Indian, and he had an unbelievable memory. People just were amazed by it. And so people would come to him all the time and ask him, you know, really weird questions to see if he could remember. One fellow walked up to him and he said, what did you have for breakfast July 23rd, 1961? And the Indian said, eggs. The guy left. About a year later, he came back, happened to be going through there again. He walked in, he saw the Indian, and he said, how? And the Indian said, fried. Praise the Lord. So, good memory.
Yeah.
I've had problems thinking, remember what I had yesterday morning. Amen. But I must have had something because I'm still going. Amen. Praise God. Anyway, God is great. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And I'm going to be brief tonight. I keep saying that, but for the last few weeks, I've lied. And we had some technical glitches that got worked out last week, but then things just kind of escalated and I went a little longer than I intended. But I'm going to be brief tonight. So. Praise the Lord. I'd like, to, Mike, if you would, go to Song of Solomon, chapter 2, and verse 6. Thank you. I forget to turn it on, and then I forget to turn it off. So it's just, as I said, fried. That's all I know. How? Praise the Lord. All right. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, and verse 6. I've never done a really deep study in this. I remember years ago, in fact, right when we first came into this church, Suzanne had a whole tape series on Song of Solomon, and I wasn't ready for it, I got to tell you right now, praise the Lord. But there is some really powerful stuff in here, and it is about the Lord and how He relates to us as the bride, you know, and I just... I'm ready now. I've gone back to it, and there is some beautiful things in there. There really is. And once you kind of get the whole picture of what God's trying to convey to us. So I'm not really teaching from here tonight, although I want to use this as a way of kind of presenting what I do want to talk to you about. So, you know, the thing I have known for a long time, you know, Jesus said, or it was said of Jesus, in the volume of the book, he's on every page of this thing. If we're looking for him, you know what I mean, and that's the important thing to remember. Sometimes it's so easy to get into Old Testament things and think, well, you know, Jesus isn't. I'm not saying that the law is something we're supposed to be under, but everything in that Old Testament is pointing to Jesus. It's trying to get us to see a greater understanding, a greater revelation of God, and the beauty of and the wisdom of God is just, it's just unsurpassable. Praise the Lord. So, volume of the book is all about Jesus. So, Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 6, he says, His left hand is under my head, His right hand doth embrace me. Left hand under my head and the right hand. He's talking about grace and truth. And from that place, I'd like us to go to John chapter 8, verses 3 and 11. left hand under my head, and his right hand doth embrace me. Grace and truth, praise the Lord. John chapter 8, verses 3 through 11 is another familiar scripture that we've all read and heard preached and studied and probably preached yourselves at times. But the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought, okay, sorry, getting ahead of myself. Keep going through verse 11. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what sayest thou? And they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down with his finger, wrote on the ground, as though he had heard them not. So when they continued asking, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without a sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning as the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, No man, Lord. Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Praise the Lord. So the woman is caught in adultery. And to understand the grace of God and how law and grace kind of conflict with each other, grace leads people to Jesus. This woman had an encounter with the Lord. Grace leads people to Jesus. So when we're dealing with people, we need to remember that. Mm-hmm. Giving them rules is not going to bring them closer to Jesus. I'm not saying there aren't things that we should, ways that we should live our lives. You know that. But I'm saying when somebody's in the middle of a mess, they've already broken all the rules. They wouldn't be in the mess. What they need is the love of God. They need to know the grace of God. Amen? And so grace leads people to Jesus. He had these religious, very religious men. Some of them probably Pharisees, you know, extremely religious people. They brought her to Jesus. And the scripture says they put her in the midst. And Jesus said nothing. If there's one thing I've learned over the years, nothing sometimes is the best thing to say. It's hard to say nothing sometimes because you're thinking, I need to respond to that, praise the Lord. You know what I mean? But Jesus, in his wisdom, he didn't say anything. And then they all kind of drift away. And I'm just kind of jumping around here a little bit, but he says, Neither do I condemn you. Nobody's condemning. Everybody left. Go and sin no more. And we see that and we say, Okay, there's the commandment. There's the law. But the truth was, he was releasing his nature, his love, his grace to her. Amen?
Amen.
What you see there is deliverance.
Yes.
She had a spirit. She had a problem. She had some issues. And Jesus delivers her by grace. Praise the Lord. The law makes demands. And the truth is, that's just like pouring gas on a fire and thinking you're going to put it out. Mm-hmm. The scripture even tells us that law increases sin.
Right.
Paul said, until I heard about covetousness, I never thought about it. And once I heard about it, that's all I could do was covet everything I saw, anything and everything. But the law sets you in the middle, makes you the focus. And grace just embraces you.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
It's liberty for the new creation to live in.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen?
Amen.
It's easy to go back and want to make people do stuff and follow some religious you're not going anywhere that way in terms of developing the relationship with the Lord. Because every time you see him enter into it, he's coming to bring liberty, to set people free, so that they can have a new life. I know this is pre-crucifixion and resurrection, but that's what this is all pointing to.
Yes.
You can have a new life now. I'm delivering you from the old. I'm not going to condemn you. I'm going to set you free. How many of you know that's what all of us needed at some point?
Amen.
In fact, we need it every day. I do anyway. That's the beauty of it. God is not setting me in the center. He doesn't want me to sit in the middle of everything and just see my guilt, my shame, my disqualification. He wants me to know, look here, I've qualified you. I took your shame. I took your guilt. And I give you grace. I give you deliverance.
Yes.
So that you can be everything I created you to be.
Yes.
The left hand turns our head towards Jesus. Grace turns us to focus on him and not on ourselves.
Amen.
Not on our failures, but on his victory.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit turns our eyes to Jesus. You know, I talk about confessing the word, and I know some people think, you know, this is a fad or something, but look, we've been doing it for years.
Yep.
It works.
Yep.
It works because it's the word of God.
Amen.
And it turns your eyes to Jesus instead of the problem.
Amen.
It's scriptural.
That's right.
And we're going to keep on doing it.
Yes.
Because it's where the victory is.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Righteous life is lived out because of the acceptance of God, not because of our hard work to make us righteous, because our righteousness is filthy rags. But a righteous life is lived out. The way we live it out is by accepting the love of God. That's why it's from the inside out rather than from the outside in. If it was all about the outside in, all we're seeing is our failures. But if we live it from the Spirit, from the inside out, it causes us to focus on Jesus. And that helps us to embrace the love that he's given us.
Amen.
This woman was in the midst. And Jesus, I don't know, there's all kinds of messages preached about what he wrote in the dirt. I don't know if he wrote anything, but what I think he was doing, he was reaching down to embrace our human existence, to go back to what we were created from, the dust of the earth.
Amen.
And he's still connected with it. He still was one with that.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. He reached down and touched this dirty little fella a bunch of times in my life. Just the dust of the earth.
Thank you, Lord.
And says that has value.
Yes, Lord.
So much value that I'll give my life for it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. All right, let's jump over to John chapter 11, and I want to read verses 43 and 44, Mike. John 11, verses 43 and 44. And I think at this time of the year, I mean, we think of it, I'm sure, all of the time, but especially on Resurrection Sunday, you know, on Passover and what we call Easter. But this is spring. So just even in the natural, when you look out, you see new life everywhere.
Yeah.
It's the cycle is starting all over, you know, and it's a whole new year, a whole new life. Trees are starting to bud, the grass is turning green, all of those things. And that's what Jesus is giving us, but he gives it to us every day. We can experience resurrection life every single day of our life. Every day we get up, his mercies are new every morning. We start a brand new life every single day. And it's whatever we desire it to be. God will help us to make that a reality if we follow him, if we stay connected with him. So here he says, and when he thus had spoke, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. Praise the Lord. the grave clothes, and we've all heard it, it's the religion, it's the, you know, the binding, the things that keep us, but the truth is it kept resurrection life from coming forth. The things of the world, the things, natural things and religious things, stop resurrection life from coming out. Amen? And we've got to have this. It's not enough to just be born again. We want to live resurrected lives. Amen? Jesus wants us to live life and live it abundantly. He wants us to experience everything that He has planned and destined for our lives. And you cannot do that without living resurrected, without living His life, without having His life living through us. Amen? For that, you've got to be conscious. You've got to be inside conscious. You've got to be aware that this resurrection life is in me. Jesus Christ is in me. Why? Because He wants to live. He wants to live out through us. He wants to be exposed. He wants the tomb, the stone rolled away every day.
Yes.
So that He can be seen, so that He can be known. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let me just show you this. John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32. John 8, 31 and 32. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on Him, "If you continue in My word, then are you My disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free." We love that. "And you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free." Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. What He says, when you look at that, you think, of course, we all say, yes, know the truth. The truth will make you free. Why? Because the truth says, by His stripes you were healed.
Yes.
The truth says, amen, He became poor that you might become rich, that He wants to prosper. No weapon formed against you can prosper. Amen. He wants you to know. The truth is, you have been delivered.
Yes.
You've been set free. The truth is, you've been born again. Amen. All of that, we agree with all of it, right? But the deal is, how do you get the truth? It's verse 31. We shout about 32, but we forget about 31. Continue in My word.
Yes.
Continuing in the word is how that truth becomes a reality to your life instead of just being on the pages. I've said it before. This is mustard seed.
Yes.
And until somebody says it, until somebody agrees with it and believes it, it doesn't get sown. It's still that tiny little seed. The moment you release it,
yes,
you've sown it.
There you go.
If you'll continue to believe that and continue in His word, it will produce a huge crop.
Yes.
It'll produce whatever the word was sent to produce.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. See, grace and word, those, that's not just a message. I mean, it isn't just a something we do. It's a revelation of Jesus. It's our true identity. Praise the Lord. It's who we are and why we are. It leads us to truth. Truth that sets us free. Truth that gives us liberty. Just like the woman caught in the act of adultery. She came into contact with grace and truth.
Yes.
And the result was, she was set free.
Thank you, Lord.
No condemnation. That's what I needed. That's what everybody needs. The cry of the human heart all around us is, I want to be free. That's why they get drunk. That's why they get high. That's why they run from relationship to relationship. That's why they got to have a bigger house, got to have this, got to have that, got to have all of that stuff. Because they're looking for freedom, but they don't know where to find it. So you look at Hollywood and some of the places with the where the most money is, have the most things, and are the most bound,
right,
and the most miserable.
Yes.
When all they need is Jesus. And they could be free. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
By the religion, this woman was going to be lawed to death.
Yes.
They were going to stone her. And Jesus loved her. He graced her,
yes,
to life. And that more abundantly. Because now not only can she live, but she can live free.
Yes.
She can have a new life. A life without shame, without guilt, without condemnation.
Yes.
Romans chapter 10, verses 8 through 11. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Praise the Lord. That's how we get saved. That's how the kingdom works.
Yes.
Believing and saying. The woman said, he asked her, where are those that condemn you? And she said, there are none, Lord. He said, neither do I condemn you. It's a picture of salvation.
Yes.
It's a picture of Romans chapter 10.
Yes.
I know it's Old Testament, I get that. But I'm saying everything Jesus does, he's pointing to a greater truth. He's pointing to the reality that God wants there to be for each and every one of us. Praise the Lord. You've been qualified. You've been accepted in the blood.
Amen.
You know, legalism is so worried about acting right that it turns us into actors.
Yeah.
It all becomes external, and we have a difficulty being real. And anybody that's ever been in that knows, you feel guilty. You feel like a hypocrite. Because you know you got to fit in with the peer group. And the truth is, none of them are doing it perfectly either. But nobody can be honest. And the result is, we're in the midst. And Jesus is in the background somewhere.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Your left hand under my head so that I can see from your perspective. So go, he says, in your deliverance. We've been qualified for the journey. Enjoy the journey.
Yes.
Go, sin no more. Praise the Lord. God is good all the time.
Amen.
All the time, God is good, right?
Yes.
That's true. That's more than just something we say. It's the truth. I was watching, I think it's Ben Siegel. And he said, the Jews, you know, the common way Jews interact with one another is if someone were to say, how are you today? Their response would be, Baruch Hashem. Thank the name. Or we would say, thank God. No matter what they say, how you doing? How have you been? Baruch Hashem. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In other words, I'm here right now because of God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. That ought to be the way we talk. That ought to be the way we... How you doing now? How you feeling? Thank the Lord. It's just another way of saying praise the Lord. God is good. Baruch Hashem. The name. Grace and truth. His left arm under my head. His right arm embracing me.
Amen.
Thank the Lord.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord.